talk about gauge R&R study. This is the most popular method of analyzing a measurement system's capability within the MSA. Gauge R&R stands for gauge repeatability and reproducibility. This is a method used to calibrate measuring systems, especially those recommended for the automotive industry. This method provides a quantitative means of selecting a measuring instrument, and is used to decide whether a given instrument is suitable for evaluating the product or process parameter with regard to its actual variability or the variability defined in the specification requirements. You can analyze the gauge R&R study using one of the following analysis techniques: analysis of variance, ANOVA, range method, average and range method. Each method has its advantages and may be suitable for measurement system analysis in certain cases and with regard to specific requirements. Analysis of variance, ANOVA, is a statistical method employed for examining the dependence relationship of all the causes for the generation of a variability in a measurement. This method was established in the 1920s. To put it simply, this method verifies whether the independent variable affects the dependent variable. Outside of science, this method is very rarely used due to its complexity, and we will not discuss it thoroughly. Range method. This method can provide an overall view of the variability of the measurement system, as it does not distribute variability due to repeatability and reproducibility. Therefore, the result from the analysis of a measurement system may not be complete or satisfactory. This method will not be discussed either. The average and range method is the most commonly used method in practice, as it allows for the assessment of both repeatability and reproducibility. By using this approach, we will obtain the most complete and accurate view of how the measurement system operates. This method will be thoroughly discussed in this lesson. In order to conduct the gauge R&R study, we have to consider the rules that we applied for this purpose. The procedure described is an example and will help us prepare for the study. The first issue is to appoint appraisers, the so-called controllers. These are people taking the measurements of the prepared part samples. In most cases, these are production workers, operators, or quality workers, quality controllers. Owing to the fact that we want to test our measurement system comprehensively, the study will be performed by two or three appraisers, preferably. In this way, human variability, that is, his or her competence and correctness of taking measurements, will be brought into consideration. The second issue is related to selecting the samples needed for the measurement system analysis. These are parts or samples of parts. Of course, we also need to know the measured feature, the characteristic of our product. For instance, this may be a dimension or weight. In addition, in order to obtain a reliable result, the sample size can't be too small. Usually this will be around 10 separate prepared part items. Why? This stems from the fact that we need to consider the variability within the measurements of the parts. All in all, each part will be slightly different from each other in terms of characteristic and from the required nominal value. The aforementioned parts do not have to be the same. It will be even better if the products represent the entire variability of the process. Another issue is part numbering. Each part is assigned a sample number. However, we do this in such a way so that the appraiser does not see it. Therefore, the controller can't be influenced by the sample number, as only the R&R study leader knows which sample is which. Then, in taking the measurements, the process is carried out under the supervision of the study leader. In order to ensure that we account for the variability of the measurement that results from its way of performance and the method selected, we can't take just one measurement. It is usually recommended to conduct at least two tests for each piece, separately by each appraiser. In most cases, there are 2, 3, or 4 tests conducted, usually 3. Finally, gauge R&R calculation. This is the phase that takes place upon collection of all data and is conducted by the study leader, for instance, a metrologist. Once the statistical parameters are calculated, means, ranges, and variability, the study leader interprets the results obtained. In order to make the appropriate calculations, we start by calculating the ranges in the measurements taken by successive appraisers for subsequent parts. Having such data at hand, we are able to calculate the average of the range for each appraiser. We therefore mark each appraiser A, B, C, and obtain the following ranges, RA, RB, RC. Having the average of ranges as generated by each appraiser, we can calculate the final average of the range for the whole study. We add the individual ranges together and divide by their number. Now we will have to look at the statistical tables and calculate the value of the standard deviation, SE, for repeatability. This can be done by dividing the final average of the range by the parameter D2 that can be taken from the appropriate table. This is a normal distribution parameter that depends on the number of parts measured and the number of appraisers and the number of tests conducted. Finally, we can calculate the repeatability, the so-called equipment variation, EV. Here we apply the standard formula by multiplying the value of the previously calculated standard deviation, SE, by the constant 5.15, where 5.15 times SE represents 99% of the measurement results for a normal distribution. In the subsequent step, we calculate the average value X for all the parts tested, based on the previously calculated averages for the individual parts. We then calculate the range of the average values for the parts by subtracting the minimal mean value from the maximum mean value. The step is to calculate XDIF range for the individual appraisers. Now it's time to calculate the appraiser variation, AV, by substituting the previously calculated parameters into the appropriate formula. Finally, we can calculate the output parameters for the measurement system, that is, repeatability and reproducibility, R&R, part variation, PV, total variation, TV. Now it's time to make an assessment. For this purpose, it is useful to calculate R&R percentage value as a ratio of R&R to TV in percentage, which will give us the opportunity to use the acceptance criteria of the measurement system. If the R&R percentage value is less than 10%, we can accept such a measurement system without any additional comments or conditions. If the R&R percentage value is less than 10%, then the system is better for measuring a given characteristic of a product. If the R&R percentage value is greater than 10%, but less than 30%, we can accept such a system under certain conditions. Here, the decision must be taken by the study leader, for instance, a metrologist. If the R&R percentage value is greater than 30, then the system may not be accepted. The cause of the inaccuracies should be found and removed, or the measurement method should be changed. Now it's time for some practice. We will do the gauge R&R study together.